Hey guys, here we are on Easter Sunday, and we are finishing this series of devotions about the last week in the life of Jesus. And obviously, as we come to Resurrection Sunday, Jesus rises from the dead. Praise God. The grave and the tomb cannot keep him. But I want to ask you the question. There was a book written one time about the resurrection of Jesus Christ entitled, Who Moved the Stone? And that question is answered in the Gospels, that an angel came and moved the stone. But I want to ask that question in a different way. Why was the stone moved? And you know, the obvious answer you might say was to let Jesus out of the tomb. But we're going to examine that today and see if that was really the reason that the stone was removed. Now remember that Jesus was put in the tomb on Friday evening. He's in the tomb before sundown, before Sabbath begins, and everything happened in a hurry. Jesus gets off the cross at 3 o'clock that afternoon. They take him down, check his side, make sure he's dead, the water and the blood and all of that. So Jesus is brought down off the tomb, off the cross, and he is placed in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. They quickly try to wrap his body in linens, and they use spices. Joseph got a lot of those things ready. But anyway, they only had a very short time because the tomb has to be shut by sundown. He has to be in the tomb. It's got to be completed. It's really amazing. They did all of that in just a matter of a couple, 2.5, 3 hours. They get all this taken care of and all of this done. And then so Jesus is in the tomb from before sundown on Friday, part of Friday, obviously all of Saturday, and he is resurrected by the time that the women get there on Sunday morning. Now, people say, well, wasn't he in the tomb for 3 days? Yes, the Jews counted if it was a part of any day, it was considered a day. So Jesus is in the tomb part of Friday, that's one day, all of Saturday, that's the second day, and then part of Sunday, very early part of Sunday morning, so that's the third day, and that's how the scripture is accurate when it says that he is in the tomb 3 days. It doesn't mean 72 hours. The Jewish way of counting was any part of a day is considered as a whole day. So you have Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So anyway, early on Sunday morning, the women are coming to the tomb to finish the job of anointing the body of Jesus. Now remember, all that had to be done in a hurry on Friday. So after the Sabbath was over, and the Sabbath at sundown, as the Sabbath came to an end, the night before, the women go out and they buy these spices. All the Jewish shops would reopen after sundown, after the Sabbath was over, on what we would call Saturday night by our way of calculating things. So they go and they buy these spices after the Sabbath is over. And then early on the first day of the week, which obviously is Sunday, early on Sunday morning, they're coming to the tomb to anoint the body of Jesus. Now, as they come to the tomb, the topic of conversation obviously is who is going to move the stone. Jesus was buried in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. This is a classic rolling stone tomb. And what it is, think of these tombs would have an entrance. And you'd have this stone that was kind of in this trough, and it would roll back and forth. And you can actually move the stone back and forth. There's a replica of this actually in northern Israel today. You can see this. You can move the stone back and forth until it falls in the little hole there. When it falls in the hole, it kind of boom in the divot. That's how it seals a rolling stone tomb. Think of this. The stone falls in it. Boom. The stone is there. And the stone can weigh a couple of tons. You can actually move it as long as the trough back and forth and roll it. Once it's there, it's there. And not only that, remember this, that they had gone to Pilate, the Jews had, and asked for a guard. So it was sealed with a Roman seal. And also there were 4 guards in front of it. So as the women are coming to the tomb, they're going, well, who's going to move the stone? And you know, what about if the guards are still there? They didn't say that, but I'm sure that's in the back of their minds. How are we going to deal with all of these things? When they get there, the problem of anointing the body of Jesus becomes the least of their concerns. Because when they get to the tomb, what they discover is this. The tomb is empty. The stone is gone. The stone has been rolled away. So the problem of who will move the stone is resolved. The second issue, anointing the body, well, the body of Jesus isn't there. So that's not an issue anymore. Jesus' body is gone. And then they run into an angel. The Gospels will say this. Apparently there were two angels there. They have this conversation with this one angel in Mark's Gospel. You read all the Gospels to put it together. They have the conversation, and the angel tells them, I know you're here seeking the body of Christ. He has risen as he said. He is not here. So, remember the question we asked, why was the stone moved? So, the classic answer that we all, I think, would in our minds at first glance say, well, the stone is moved so that the resurrected Christ can come out. But is that really the reason the stone is removed? In John 20:26, if you go there, you can read this, that there's a point after the resurrection when the 11 are together, and Thomas is with them at this time. Remember the story of doubting Thomas. We don't have time to begin their day, but now Thomas is with them. And they are in a room, the doors are closed, everything's locked, and who comes through the door? Not opening the door, but through a closed door. In other words, the laws of physics are not applying to Jesus at this time as we know them. He just passes his resurrected body through this door, and he comes in, and he greets the apostles there. You know, it's an incredible scene as you see all of that taking place. In fact, let's look at that. It's over in the Gospel of John. It's John chapter 20, verse 26. After 8 days, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas with them. Jesus came, the doors having been shut, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." And this is where he tells Thomas to look and to see and to touch. And Thomas gives that great answer, "My Lord and my God." But the point is this. If Jesus could pass through those doors at that time, could he have not passed physically through the stone that was in the entrance of the tomb of Joseph Arimathea where he was laid? Now remember, this is incredible because not only did Jesus pass through the doors when he came and ministered to and saw and showed himself to the 11, Thomas being in that group, but also remember this, that John's Gospel record that Peter and John come early in the morning to the tomb having received the message that Jesus' body is not there. They don't know where his body is. And they come, and John apparently gets there first, and then Peter gets there, but being more impetuous, he goes on inside. And then John comes in, and John, with his very keen, discerning eye, sees the grave clothes, the linens, and the napkin. And they are, in a way, almost that they weren't ripped off of Jesus like somebody else would have done, or even he would have done at the resurrection, you would think, as he kind of unwrapping himself. But as if his body had physically passed through those grave clothes. They were intact. Almost you think of a mummy that's there, and the clothes are there intact. They're not ripped up. Or think of perhaps, I know this might not be the greatest illustration, but you know, a shed of a snake, and kind of in one tact. It is as if the resurrected body of Christ just passes through physical things now. He passed through the grave clothes. He passed through the door. Well, hey, there didn't need to be somebody to open the door to let Jesus in. There didn't need to be somebody to unwrap the grave clothes. There didn't need to be somebody even to move the stone that is in front of the tomb, because Jesus, he has a body, but he has a resurrected body that can now pass through physical things. So we come back to the original question. Why was the stone removed? And this is what I believe with all of my heart. The stone is not removed to let Jesus out. The stone is removed to let the women, the apostles, and all subsequent believers into Christ. Think of that. The stone is not a barrier to Christ. And the stone should not be a barrier to us. We serve a risen Savior. We serve an empty tomb, because our Savior has resurrected, and he is the right hand of God. What an incredible body Jesus has. But I think more than anything else, if we think about it, I love what 1 John chapter 3, verse 2 states. Beloved, it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but when we see him, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. That incredible resurrected body of Christ that can pass through physical objects, that is not limited, we will have a body somewhat like that. Now think of that on this great Easter resurrection day. The stone was removed, not so much to let Jesus out, because he didn't need the stone to be removed to get out, but the stone is removed to let us in. God bless you. Have a wonderful Easter.